Thank you, Mr. Ambassador, for agreeing with this interview. My first question. Why do you think they chose the military involved in the coup? Why do you think they chose this very moment, this day, for the military coup? Was there a particular reason for them?
As you know, in my country, there is a group which is called FETÖ in abbreviations. This is the followers of Gülen's cult. Beginning from 2014, Gülenist members, which are clandestinely operating in key state institutions, were to be identified, and they were asked or sacked from these key positions. And for these 2 years, despite the warnings of our intelligence agencies, in the military, there was not a major search or purge in that sense of Gülenists. Every year in August, Military High Council gathers. This is ordinary and regular. And there, the generals, the top generals, prime minister as well, it's chaired by the prime minister. They decide who will promote and who will not. So this August, it will be in the first week of August, it was planned. As I said, this was regular. We understand that there was a plan to make a major shift in the ranks of higher ranks and also in the officer level.
A reshuffle of
taking these Gülenists out of the army, of course within the legal means and ways, within the territory of what law says. And probably they got intelligence that the government and the top brass are actually trying to do this. So they just pushed the button at an early time, just before this military high council.
So this would be the trigger for the plot.
That's what we think. Yes.
But the president and also the government are accusing Fethullah Gülen and his people inside the Turkish state for organizing the plot. Do they have evidences on that? And what kind of evidences?
The government says there are concrete evidence. Obviously, we read it from our outlets as well. Even the number one suspect, or the one who is arrested in this case, which is the former Air General, but who is still in the army. He will retire this August, so he has another job. So he's not retired now.
Okay.
Even in his testimony to the prosecutor, which he signed, he said, "I'm not involved in this coup, but I believe that this is done by the FETÖ group, by the Gülenists." Even he says this. There are other quite interesting developments in this case. For example, within the tanks, they captured police officers wearing military uniforms who are connected with the Gülen cult. Because as I told you beginning from 2 years ago, especially in the police, there was a huge search of these people, and some of the police officers were already sacked from the police or taken to a position where they do not have an active duty. So they caught people within the tanks of these people who are connected to Gülen's people. Secondly, the helicopter pilot who took these people to assassinate or capture President Erdogan in Marmaris, after the shootings, they caught the pilot, and over the pilot, they found the verse, the religious verse written by Fethullah Gülen, for instance. And now, as you know, there are thousands of people who were arrested, and their testimonies are coming slowly, and from inside sources are saying there are people who are confessing that it's a Gülenist plot.
Coming back to the plot, to the coup on Friday, there were some Turkish officials. We heard them or we saw their declaration in the Turkish press, which accused the United States of America of involvement in this coup. And the American ambassador in Ankara wrote about this in his public statement. Do you think this is the case, that the USA were involved, or some officials from the USA were involved in preparing the coup?
Well, our society in this region have similar reaction and tendencies. In the society, there is a huge resentment of what has happened, because hundreds of civilians were killed by these coup plotters. Turkish real soldiers, real army, never targets Turkish parliament, for example, or civilians, without looking, you know, whether they are civilians or not. So there's a great outrage in the society, and everybody believes that it's because of Gülen. This is not only a small portion of the society, but this is a predominant sense of understanding, including the opposition masses also believe that Gülen is behind it. So when they see that Gülen is residing happily in the United States, they jump into a conclusion that the United States could be behind this coup. But this is obviously not our official position. United States is our strategic partner, a strong ally for decades, and we are in constant touch with our American partners. Just yesterday, President Obama and President Erdogan spoke on the phone, and they said they will work together to identify the motives of this heinous attempt. Also, they from the very first hours of the attempt, they went out publicly, both President Obama and Secretary Kerry, and said that they condemn this attempt, who targeted the legitimate democratically elected government of Turkey. Now we just started the legal procedure to ask the extradition.
Turkey sent the official file
of this dangerous cult from the U.S.
Okay, if the Americans were not involved, do you think that were there any other external forces involved in this coup?
It will be for sure when the prosecutors finish their job. After the statements, the interrogations, or testimonies, we'll see what other motives could have a role in it. But at this stage, it's pretty clear that it's a Gülenist movement. Whether there is another outside force who used the Gülenist in the army to attack to Turkish democracy will be identified after that.
We see an unprecedented crackdown on public servants, on military, army forces, followed by what seems a purge on education and judiciary. Yesterday we learned that tens of thousands of teachers, deans in the universities are suspended from their duties. Which is their main fault, their main guilt?
The main guilt of their being a member of, again, this Gülenist cult, Gülenist terrorist group. For years, they started to build this empire, if I may say, in 1970s. So it's a long, long effort to actually gather people, pass their ideology, and put them into key institutions. And in these decades, there were times where Fethullah Gülen himself was tried by the courts also, but there were also times, especially in the last 10 years, where in general they are supported both by the government and majority of the society, because people tended to believe them that they are a benign organization, opening schools, waving Turkish flags abroad, everywhere in the world, you know, from Bucharest to Africa to the United States. So people were seeing them as a benign organization. So given this, in all state institutions, there are thousands of Gülenists who are actually hiding their real motives, because they fear if they say that they are Gülenists, it's against the rule of the state. That's why they were called as Parada state, so meaning that they are not getting instructions from.
So now it is illegal for a Turkish citizen to be part of this movement?
It is never illegal. Okay. There are people in the Turkish state or everywhere in the country who have private affiliations to religious groups or non-religious ones or, or, you know, any kinds of ideological leanings. But when this group is identified as a threat to national security, then obviously the individual is also becoming a threat to the government. So this
you have a law saying that this organization is a terrorist
yes.
one.
Yes, our National Security Council declared FETÖ as a terrorist group.
When
they did it, they did it recently. About months ago, like I guess like 3 months ago.
Yeah.
But before this, as I say, beginning from 2014, FETÖ, by our intelligence people, were identified as a very dangerous group.
Mm-hmm.
And after that, after 2014, prosecutors opened many different cases connected mm-hmm. with the group. For example, one of the cases is to do with the entrance exams to the state institutions.
Mm-hmm.
So what they did is they stole the questions because they have members okay. everywhere and give it to their followers, and their followers predominantly won the exams to go to the, any key institutions.
Mm-hmm.
And there is concrete evidence by these prosecutors for 3 consecutive years there are people who made hundreds questions correct at the same time.
Okay.
And when they check their affiliation, they are all linked together somehow. So this is not one uniform people working in the military or in the police, but everywhere.
Mm-hmm.
Because it's a matter of, as I say, allegiance, a religious allegiance, which turned out to be a very dangerous force against the state. So all these people who were purged, back to your question, were actually taken into custody or taken off from their positions.
Yeah, suspended.
Suspended with the question of their being member of the Gulenis group. Of course, there will now start all these prosecutions for mm-hmm. Every of them, and to see if there are innocent people who have no ties with them, they will be get back to your jobs.
But when did the Turkish state had the time to to see the affiliation to this terrorist organization, as you call it, of these tens of thousands of persons?
As I say, once...
I mean, because it seems yes. like in 2 or 3 days since the military coup, there is a huge wave of purge
yes.
Purges in
yes.
the whole public sector.
I understand, true. As I said, beginning from 2014, in every institution, people were making their own regular checks, so who can mm-hmm. have a connection with this. Obviously, our intelligence were doing the major job there. So when the coup attempt has happened, after initial testimonies and statements
mm-hmm.
with the police and with the eligible information with the intelligence, these people were suspended. Just to take control with this very fragile moment, because
mm-hmm.
we never know what these people can do in their relevant institutions, because they are so dangerous in a sense that when you talk to them, you know, they look so, you know, benign and
okay.
and secure, but in reality they are actually ready to do everything. It's like kamikaze
mm-hmm.
People. They don't, you know, think about their future or and the country. So the state apparatus now are taking precautionary measures by suspending
okay.
these people where they suspect.
I understand.
Links.
So you're saying it's a precautionary move
from
the government in order not to see them doing something
exactly.
that would harm
exactly.
the state. But with all due respect, Ambassador, I can hardly see 15,000 teachers as kamikaze, as you.
I'm not talking about this. I'm talking about, you know, the ones in the security
the
sector.
Okay.
They are like kamikaze. But let me give you an example. The major airbase in Ankara.
Mm-hmm.
So operations were actually partly directed from there by the coup plotters.
Okay.
In the morning, when the police and the real army got control of the events, they obviously made a raid to the airbase. And in the airbase, they found an associate professor of religion working at Sakarya University.
Mm-hmm.
His name is all public, I don't remember it now. And when the police went to check his office in the school, they found the book of Fethullah Gülen.
Mm-hmm.
So they can really become kamikaze everywhere, actually. So
mm-hmm.
can you imagine what this associate professor, an academic actually, doing in the base where people are making, you know, this raid. So I know that it sounds a bit awkward
yeah.
for someone outside to understand this group, but they are really, really dangerous. And that's the reason why, for example, Russians are have closed their schools years before. The same was done by Turkmenistan. The same was done
by the schools from the Fethullah Gulen's network.
Exactly.
You're saying.
Yes.
We'll come back to to the schools a little bit later. You said that it might seem awkward what the Turkish government is doing, and in a country like Romania, where we saw
not the government, and also to understand what these people are doing. You know, because they seem. You never know what they are thinking in their minds, but clandestinely making all these plots.
In a country like Romania, where we experienced heavy purges in the last half a century during Stalinism years, for us, we have these memories of what political or ideologically motivated purges are. So we see more and more journalists, members of Western parliaments or politicians in the Western part of Europe, criticizing the Turkish government for these purges. Some of them even compare President Erdogan with Stalin. I saw piece of opinion in a Lithuanian newspaper today. Don't you fear that these people are refused the right to defend themselves, these tens of thousands?
I think a great injustice is being made to Turkey and the legitimate government of Turkey. President Erdogan in Turkey isn't effectively power for more than 12, 13 years.
Yes.
And it is in this period that Turkey has come most closer to the European values and the European Union accession membership. Turkey has opened up that much in our 90 decades of Republican history in this period.
Mm-hmm.
He is the one who actually take dramatic decisions in terms of legal changes, overhauling the constitution to become a more liberal state and also more stronger free market economy. Obviously, today what we are facing is a serious threat to European values back in Turkey, what these populators are doing. Can you imagine that people are a group of people within the military, whatever their leanings are, having no authority from the army generals, the top generals, and without knowing their ideology, there is no ideology. If they are, let's say, a kind of particular ideology and saying that I did this for this, you can understand at least their motives. But in this case, they are even hiding that they are a member of this Gulenist cult, and they are targeting civilians, the parliament, and effectively killing whatever democracy remains in the country. So in this moment, our European friends should actually show solidarity with Turkey against this coup. The major thing that I would like to underline here is not a matter of President Erdogan or the Turkish government itself. All Turkish opposition figures and strata of the society are harshly and strongly against this military coup. The pro-Kurdish MPs, the left-wing main opposition party, the Nationalist Party of the opposition, they are all unequivocally condemning this outrageous attempt. And just yesterday, the leaders of different political parties also got together again. The Prime Minister met with the two main opposition parties, and they gave similar messages that this is not acceptable. So it's not a matter of, I would like to underline this. Actually, this is well known, but people tend to forget this. This is not a coup attempt which is supported by a portion of the society. There's no such thing. Society is unequivocally altogether against this attempt, including the dissidents, including the opposition figures.
We saw in the last days, as you mentioned, all the political leaders, be it from the government or in the opposition, gathering around the democratic elected government and supporting it. And as we saw, the European and the American leaders saluting the victory of the loyal forces, army forces, in this in the Friday event, and saying that they will only discuss with the democratic elected government, and
yes.
in Turkey. But we also saw some warnings from European leaders saying that it would be unacceptable if Turkey is coming back to the and is reinforcing the death penalty. Do you think that if the parliament, the Turkish parliament, will take this decision, will vote this decision, is Turkey ready to confront the risk of effectively ceasing the negotiation with the European Union?
European Union membership is a strategic objective of Turkey, and it still remains as such.
Yeah.
Obviously, in the course of recent years, we are pretty much frustrated by the behavior of the EU and certain EU capitals, mm-hmm. Which even in certain cases goes to the degree of humiliating a whole nation just because it's Muslim or being outsider or outlander. So there is a huge frustration from time to time within the society, and obviously our leaders should take these resentments into consideration. Mm-hmm. The rising populism in Europe or xenophobia in Europe unfortunately also affects European leaders' attitude and communities' attitude towards Turkey and the Turkish people. So it's not an easy process at mm-hmm. all. But on the state level, this is still a strategic objective. Obviously, death penalty was something that we abolished more than a decade ago,
oh, yes.
as part of our commitment to the EU and also to the Council of Europe, which we are a member of it,
course. So,
and we are a founding member of it. Now, as I say, there's a strong outrage and frustration within the society against these coup plotters, and on the streets, people do not sleep for 4 days. Mm-hmm. People are out on the streets because we really do not know where these people are, where they are hiding, as I say. Mm-hmm. So we fear that they could attempt, you know, something outrageous because, as I say, they're acting like kamikaze. That's why people are on the street, not leaving. It's democracy, it's government, it's leaders. So on the streets, they chant slogans for the reinstating of the death penalty. President Erdogan says, if it comes to me after the parliament, I will support this. And he gave the examples of the U.S., for example, as a democracy introducing or applying death penalty. But there are different opinions in the society and in the political spectrum. Prime Minister Erdogan, Prime Minister Yildirim said, we will act cautiously, not mm-hmm. hastily. We'll be very careful on these issues, and we'll take into consideration our international obligations as well. So, as I say, this is a functioning democracy, no matter how some people tend to see Turkey as a, you know, third world country like dictatorship. There are functioning institutions, mm-hmm. and you cannot, you know, introduce one thing at one night without, you know, just applying due processes of parliament and other political parties.
I was also interested in your personal opinion, even if, of course, you're the ambassador and you're presenting the Turkish government's opinion, but you are also part of the elite of the Turkish state, and it's the duty of the elite of any country to not to fall into populism and, as you mentioned, the European populism, which is a problem, of course, and to make a few steps back from the heat of the day and then take the wiser decisions. Sometimes, despite of what the people are asking in the street. So
yes,
I was interested
saying,
in your personal
sure.
Well,
as a diplomat,
yes.
It's not that appropriate to share my personal opinion than on the record.
Yes.
You know, meeting. So I just can say it will be decided in a democratically mm-hmm. Run process. Obviously, death penalty is not applied in any of the European countries.
Mm-hmm.
So Turkey is part of the European family. That's why it will have huge repercussions and problems in our mm-hmm. Relationship with that. But in the end, it is the political mechanism who will decide for that. There is already some political figures who are saying this is wrong. And there are also some political figures, like the second biggest opposition party, who is saying, no, we have to adopt it. So it's still under live discussion. Obviously, as a young diplomat, I see the future of my country in Europe. It has always been as such. And when I'm saying Europe, it's not necessarily within the EU, because you don't need to be an EU member to be European in a real sense. So the Turkish society will probably continue to protect its already strong place in Europe.
We saw Prime Minister Yildirim threatening any country that would stand by Mr. Gulen, and any country won't be a friend of Turkey and will be considered at war with Turkey, and I quoted Reuters and BBC News. Isn't this statement a little bit too much, that suggesting that if the United States would not extradite Mr. Gulen, it is automatically into war with Turkey?
You know, Gulen threat is so big for us, and until now, our friends and allies didn't understand the proportion of the danger. But now we saw it very dearly. So we really want this guy back to Turkey. Obviously, we are also talking, as I say, with our American friends, and we will follow the due process. It's not that, you know, we want him and then you just send it back to us in a plane. This is not the case. We know the procedural things, and we already did what is necessary. And we will continue to work with them. And American officials are also making similar statements that they will continue to work with the Turkish authorities.
We saw last
to solve this problem.
Yesterday's statement of yes. The White House on
yes.
this.
So this is a process of talking between allies and friends.
Can you imagine? Can you project what would happen in the bilateral relations if Washington will not extradite?
I don't believe that they will not extradite, so I don't think it's a major problem over there. Turkish-US relationship is a very solid one. There have always been ups and downs and problems in decades, but the issues that we are facing together are so big that none of us could actually ignore one another. So it's a solid relationship, and it will move forward as such.
I saw yesterday a piece of news in the Iranian National Press Agency, IRNA, which caught my attention because it affects, or it has the potential of affecting the regional situation. The Iranian press agency quoted Mr. Erdogan as saying, and I quote, "Turkey is firmly willing to work with Iran and Russia to settle regional crisis and restore peace and stability to the region." Is Turkey signaling through this a shift in the external policy away from EU, from NATO, and from the United States?
As you know, we are facing tremendous challenges in the region. And these challenges are increasing, unfortunately. It's not fading down. There is now a coalition of more than 60 countries fighting against ISIS. We have many gains, correct, but still ISIS, unfortunately, shows an ability to make attacks everywhere in the world, from Europe to Africa to Middle East to Turkey. This is only one challenge. The other challenge is the huge refugee crisis. The other challenge is the stability and unity of Iraq. So there are many challenges in the region. As you know, Turkey has a new government, or new cabinet, to say.
Yeah.
It changed a couple of months ago. And our new prime minister made a couple of strong statements saying that Turkey will decrease the number of its enemies and increase the number of friends. Under such circumstances, it's not viable to continue like this. So it's actually the continuation of this policy. That's why Turkey tried to mend ties with Russia, with Israel. We already have good relationship with our neighbor Iran already. So it's not a kind of policy shift or a change. For years, we do not see our relationship with these major partners in the region as an alternative to our Western alliance and allegiance. It has always been like this. There is not this one or that one, okay. But it's both for Turkey, and it should work as such under such difficult geography conditions.
I ask you this because these days, these tough days for Turkey, of course, I also see a lot of anti-European and anti-American articles in the Turkish press,
yeah.
And also a lot of anti-European or anti-American rhetoric from Turkish officials.
So yeah.
When you connect these two things, you can think as a journalist mm-hmm. at this potential shift.
I see. No, these comments is nothing to do with the shift, but it is most because of like action-reaction thing.
Mm-hmm.
Because also in the European press, in the American press, you also see a very strong tide of anti-Turkishness, especially anti-President Erdogan attitude. Mm-hmm. Yesterday, New York Times put a headline of a news covering the coup plot, saying that Turkish nation are like sheep,
mm-hmm.
and they follow whatever Erdogan says.
I saw that you reacted on
that's
Twitter.
That's a huge humiliation. Yes. And unfortunately, there became what I call as a obsessive-compulsive Erdogan disorder
mm-hmm.
In the Western press. So whatever you know he's saying or doing is in after 10 minutes is on the European press and with this after the coup event the general coverage was also quite negative. So there is also a reaction now. So this is the action on the Turkish press. Majority of the reactions are quite negative. I don't see this as healthy.
But I have. At least from my part, an explanation for this kind of behavior, because we as journalists or politicians here in Europe, we also see what is happening now in Turkey as a process through which President Erdogan is taking more and more control on the country or on the society by purging all his enemies inside the army, inside the government,
okay,
inside. It's hard to understand how this Gulenist movement that you are calling a terrorist one was able to become such a powerful force inside the Turkish state in the last 12 or 13 years when Mr. Erdogan was in power.
I told you this movement started in 1970s.
Of course.
It's not in the last 10 years also.
Yeah.
So they raise kids at the young age and put to these key institutions by hiding their real mm-hmm. motives. This is a very big scheme. So it's not surprised that all these people are now found in the military, in the police. What is now is different is that these people were being tolerated before because mm-hmm. we were thinking, as you say, like anyone working in the state institution can have private feelings or allegiance to any kind of ideology. So we were thinking that it was a benign ideology. But after 2014, after they all wiretap illegally mm-hmm. the phones of not only the top leaders of the country, but also all dissident, in their eyes obviously, journalists or others, it was a shock for all the nation, and we saw that these people are so dangerous and they have an ugly face operating clandestinely behind,
mm-hmm.
In spite of the bright face they were showing with schools and all these tolerance rhetoric. So that's why they are still a huge danger, and everybody in Turkey knows this, and everybody in Turkey believes that they are a huge threat. So that's why also the Turkish people do not understand the reaction from the other side. Mm-hmm. I know it's difficult as a diplomat working abroad to explain it to our interlocutors and to the audience, but people also get quite upset of the coverage showing Turkey as a third world country, like a dictatorship.
Mm-hmm.
People, you know, just cannot go out. This is not real Turkey. Obviously, politically, people can criticize the particular decisions of leaders, as it is here,
yeah.
Obviously, there's harsh criticism, which is quite normal in the political strata, but using, you know, slanders or just attacking the whole, you know, country as it is what people make people quite furious, actually. And it actually alienates the European masses also in the country. It pushed Turkey away. This has happened also in our EU membership process. EU made great mistakes. Of course, Turkey made mistakes on its part because it's a, you know, like a dance, as you know, like a tango. But on the other hand, EU leaders, some of the EU leaders in the past, we can name President Sarkozy, for example, because of his you know, political base, whatever political considerations, the rhetoric that was used by such leaders or some leaders in Austria, for example, it actually pushed Turks out mentally, saying that, well, these guys are, you know, humiliating us and they don't see us as Europeans, so why shall I, you know, try to be with them? So let's go back to our, you know, own roots and to our history, to regional alliances. So these are unfortunately natural reactions.
Coming back to the to our region, how do you see the privileged relationship between Romania, Turkey, and maybe Poland that we saw in the NATO summit? We also have a trilateral. Negotiation format. Do you think that Turkey will maintain this strategic approach with this eastern flank of NATO, given the new strategy of the Turkish government towards Russia or Iran?
Obviously, we'll continue our strategic partnerships. We value this trilateral mechanism. As you know, we raised it to the level of foreign ministers. For the first time, we had a meeting in Warsaw, and we will have another meeting in Bucharest soon. Our NATO membership is so solid, it's so valuable for us, and we know that it's also valuable for our allies, and there is not even a slightest backwardness on that particular allegiance, and will continue to be a strong ally of NATO. In that regard, I would like to underline that things are in order in Turkey. Institutions are working. It was a very big earthquake in the institutional system, but it's under control. And as you know, the Turkish nation and institutional memory has a very strong perseverance abilities. And you will see things will become quite normal very soon in terms of these institutional changes. On societal wise and daily livings of people, it's already quite normal. Except that in the evenings, people go on the streets, they sing songs and chant, and people give speeches. So people are happily doing their holidays in the seasides. The flights are operating, so everything is operating in the country, so there is not an abnormal situation.
Since you mentioned the Turkish state, are we going to see any big structural changes in the Turkish state in the this year or next year?
When I'm saying state, I mean this you know, purges or suspension of civil servants.
No, I was
in
I
terms
was
of state.
Of
no,
state, if you see coming any major change when it comes to the structure itself of the Turkish state?
No, we don't see any major change, obviously. It has been a long discussion about whether to change the Turkish regime to more presidential one.
Yes.
But this is, as you know, a legitimate discussion that is made by some other European countries as well. Now in Greece, for example, they are negotiating or discussing publicly whether the president should be elected by popular vote or not. But it has been going for some time.
So you don't see any new topic of discussion after this, after the coup? Any discussion about how to reform the state?
I don't know, other than what was?
Yes.
I don't expect anything. But
coming back to regional context, Romania initiated inside NATO discussions about a Navy cooperation in the Black Sea, and I spoke to the Turkish president spokesman in Warsaw, Mr. Ibrahim Kalin, who told me at that moment that, and I quote, Turkey will negotiate a new security architecture at the Black Sea. Do you still support, is Turkey still supporting a wider NATO collaboration at the Black Sea?
Obviously, Black Sea.
And in what form?
Black Sea is so vital for Turkey as well. In Black Sea, we are three, as you know, NATO countries, littoral countries,
yes.
And we have partners as well. And Black Sea is becoming increasingly an important topic of NATO, beginning from Wales, which actually was done by joint efforts of Turkish and Romanian diplomats and military personnel. So the discussion is ongoing. As you know, there are different opinions,
mm-hmm.
Of doing a particular flotilla or, you know, a training thing. There are some allies who are against it, some allies supporting it. So it's still under discussion, but we definitely support a kind of strengthening our solidarity and cooperation in the Black Sea within the format of NATO and with the support of our allies. On this we are working indeed, mm-hmm. on a new proposal, and we will continue to work with our Romanian friends.
Speaking about collaboration inside NATO, is Turkey going to send some troops in that multinational NATO brigade that Romania is going to have?
Yeah. We assigned already officers both for,
yes.
NFIU and the second one, the headquarters. For the third one, we are considering it,
mm-hmm.
but we already assigned one of our largest brigade to the command of the headquarters.
Mm-hmm.
We made it public, and with the new one, we are considering it, obviously.
You mentioned earlier the schools that belong to the Fethullah Gulen
yes.
network, and you said on Saturday, I think, at Realitatea that there are 11 schools in
yes.
Romania. Do you ask the Romanian authorities to do something about it, maybe to close them or to, I don't know, to do something about it?
Mm-hmm. We just advise our Romanian authorities to follow what they are doing. That's it.
Mm-hmm.
Actually, on Realitate, and I have made another statement after that, I didn't make any particular allegation or accusation about,
mm-hmm.
The schools doing this, doing that, etc. But they overreacted with a sense of guilt, probably, a
mm-hmm.
psychology of guilt, of saying, you know, we are working here, you know, getting these medals, he's accusing us of plot, etc.
Yeah.
No, I didn't say anything. It's on the record. People can watch this. I only shared one factual information. It is that these schools, along with many other schools in the world,
mm-hmm.
belong to the Gulenist cult. It's that easy. This is a factual thing.
Mm-hmm.
And the founders of these 11 schools here and their teachers, who are of Turkish nationality,
yes.
are followers or sympathizers of FETÖ. That's what I said. Of course, I cannot know as a foreign diplomat, and it's not appropriate in a foreign country, to say more than this, you know, they are doing this, they are doing that.
Mm-hmm.
I cannot know this. I know that the Romanian state is so strong, so they follow probably what they are doing. But in the US, for example, FBI opened an investigation to these schools,
okay.
Based on events like money laundering.
I think it was in 2013. Or?
Yes, it starts mm-hmm. recently. And using, bringing these people by showing that they are teachers in the school, so getting American visa to them, so
mm-hmm.
it's an ongoing process. As I said, in some other countries, governments shut down the schools because they see it as an Islamic threat. In Christian countries, these schools obviously do not, they are so careful not to disseminate their ideology to the kids in the schools, because it will obviously backfire and the,
mm-hmm.
the parents will realize it. But in Muslim societies where they operate, they also try to disseminate their ideology. They did this in Central Asia, for example. And some Central Asian governments closed down these schools, seeing them as a threat to their national security, like Uzbekistan, Azerbaijan, and Turkmenistan. And Russia did the same because they had schools also in parts where Muslim Russians were living.
Okay.
So particularly for Romania, as I say, I have no other accusation to this school.
So you don't have information about potential money laundering or
about
spreading some
as a diplomat,
Islamic
I don't have such thing.
Radical.
We saw in Turkey that they are really, really dangerous, and they have a very dark face behind this quite smiley and funny face.
Okay, and my last question is about the freedom of press. We spoke earlier about journalists, about media in Turkey. I was last month in Germany where I saw the Deutsche Welle Freedom of Speech Award being went to a Turkish journalist from Hürriyet. The journalist Sedat Ergin, and I spoke there and in other contexts with many Turkish journalists, and they were complaining about what is going on in Istanbul or in Ankara or in other Turkish big cities. Many of them deplored the government crackdown on the press. Do you feel comfortable to hear so many complaints about the state of the media in your country?
Of course, we are not comfortable. In a liberal democracy, freedom of press is one of the main pillars. It's so important. The problem here is that the Turkey pundits or people who are following Turkey often tend to ignore the huge challenges that Turkey is fighting currently, the larger setting. Inside the country, Turkey is fighting with more than three important major terrorist groups.
Mm-hmm.
One is being ISIS, the other being the PKK, the other being the radical left-wing. Probably they are the last remnants in the world.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe you can have some in Far East and now in Turkey, who are actually targeting foreign elements and NATO elements and American elements in Turkey. So inside the country, we have this fight with them. And outside the country, we have cornered by failed states. We have like 900 kilometers of land border, which were controlled by nine state actors. There has been continuous rocket attacks to our territory, both from ISIS and from other sources. So in that extraordinary situation, it is indeed very difficult to achieve a balance between security and freedom. In France, for example, as you know, there is a state of emergency for weeks now, and they extended months, and they extended just now. I know that there are criticisms in terms of freedom of press, and most of them are going to the Turkish courts, and there is right to individual application to the constitutional court. And in the end, everything goes to the European Courts of Human Rights, as you know, because European Human Rights have superiority over the judgments of the Turkish national courts. So I request our friends to take into consideration the huge difficulties that Turkey is facing while doing all these, unwanted, if I may say, steps. To give more concrete, for instance, now in some of our eastern cities, there is actually a city fight going between the PKK members and police or military officers. Over there, some people using their journalistic activities are going talking to these guys and actually operating as if they are giving support to the PKK. And when people are dying, obviously the prosecutors are taking them for aiding and abetting to a terrorist organization. So it's very difficult, obviously, to try to make a right balance over there. Some journalists are taken into custody of sharing secret government information with the public, with the opposition. I know these are very difficult things. You know, there is the issue of WikiLeaks, there is, Assange matter, where, the countries are stuck between achieving security on one side and securing freedom of press and judgment.
Again, Ambassador, you might be right on these punctual examples, but there is a feeling that through this crackdown on some media outlets, on journalists, to the crackdown on the Gulenist movement movement and its loyalists inside the Turkish states. The President Erdogan is now holding more and more power. That's the main concern that I can see
every day. We are all
this is the main problem, because we see Turkey as an ally in NATO, as a future probably member of the European Union, and it's a main concern.
I got your point. President Erdogan is not someone as a royal figure that came to this power by family ties. Mm-hmm. He's an elected president, and he's the first democratically by a popular vote elected president in the history of the Turkish Republic. So he's our democratically elected leader in the end. So such criticisms of him gaining so many power and etc. is like, you know, seeing him a king or figures gaining power. It's not this. In the end, there's a parliament in Turkey. Mm-hmm. There are courts in Turkey, and institutions are functioning. So there are checks and balances. So I find it not justified in terms of seeing him as if, you know, or as if showing Turkey, a country like, you know, even like North Korea, as if the Turkey is the single country in the world who is a violator of human rights, who is a violator of press freedom. You know, there are these ranks of CPJ is making. Below 100, there is EU members in this list. And I see nothing in New York Times or in any other, in Romanian press, saying that, for example, that particular EU country is 100-something in this list. But it's only Turkey targeted by the Western media. I don't see anything about, you know, I don't want to name countries because I'm a diplomat.
There are a lot of articles in the Western media about the problems in Poland with the state of law in the last months. There are a lot of articles about Romania's problems with the state of law in 2012. So I think there are concerns when a particular country has a particular problem.
Turkey is the single...
But Turkey is bigger than Romania and Poland.
Is the single democracy in the Muslim world. And unfortunately, our friends, I don't say Romania because Romania has a more strategic perspective of Turkey, but some of our friends fail to see this important point and to help the single democracy in the Muslim world to be strong. Criticism should be done. It's important because friends should criticize. Mm-hmm. And when friends criticize us, we take it serious. That's why in the last 10 years, whatever criticism came in our negotiation process, we took steps accordingly mm-hmm. to the better. But when it comes at a point where there is a major earthquake in the country, then also there is a strong backlash. I believe we will get out of all this mess stronger after this.
Thank you very much, Mr. Ambassador,
thank
for
you.
Your time.
I thank you so much.